question that I wanted to ask you, sir, is what is your comment on the importance of translation in a multilingual nation like ours?
The simple comment is that it cannot even be overemphasized. It is so important that in a country like India, where you speak different languages in different regions, the richness of these regional languages and their traditions needs to be translated, at least linguistically, into English, if not possible in other Indian languages. So I just cannot stop gushing with enthusiasm about this idea that regional language material is likely to be translated into English. I know of fiction in various languages getting translated into some other Indian languages and occasionally English as well. But this is, in a sense, a path-breaking initiative.
Thank you very much for your kind words. I also wanted to ask you specifically about the Marathi landscape of nonfiction publishing and the traditions that have happened from around 1850 onwards, if that works.
There is a rich tradition of Marathi writings of a serious non-fictional kind of genre, starting with even introductory economics and politics. You know, in the 19th century, they would introduce what are the basic principles of economics, what are the basic principles of a good state, and so on and so forth. From there, you have original thinking, but written in Marathi. You have writings of someone like Mahatma Jyotirao Phule, some of whose writings have now been translated into English. The Whipcord of the Peasant is one of the famous translations of his Marathi tract. Because he, except his presentation to the Hunter Commission, wrote exclusively in Marathi. And that is just a treasure trove of intellectual thinking about our problems then and our problems today. So I'm giving Phule only as an example because he belonged to the early mid 19th to late 19th century. But from that point onwards, you just name the subject and you will find that in Marathi, there are writings which are of valuable importance for anyone who wants to know about Indian history. I'm not talking only of Marathi history or Maharashtra's history.
In fact, I wonder, because Marathi has such a strong literary tradition, there must be also lots of nonfiction texts on an analysis of the literary community itself, not only in Marathi, but in general in about India's linguistic traditions. So yes, I agree with you, there's probably a lot of material. I wonder if you could mention where a potential applicant could find these books.
See, if you are interested in translations, or B, if you are interested in the intellectual traditions of a given language, Marathi in this case, then you would easily know where the material is already lying around. Because it is already popular in some cases in the regional language, in Marathi, and therefore people do refer to it. But libraries like the Marathi Grantha Sangrahalaya in Mumbai, which is known as the Mumbai Marathi Grantha Sangrahalaya. Grantha Sangrahalaya means library. And it is such a treasure of Marathi material, not just fiction, but non-fiction as well. Or here, where I am sitting in Pune city, you have the Bharat Itihas Samshodhan Mandal, an organization which researches in history, Indian history. Or the university's Jaikar Library of the Savitribai Phule Pune University. These are famous places. And you will find that in these two places, like Ahmednagar, Nashik, you have a tradition of city libraries. Pune also has such a city library, sometimes run by government, sometimes run by voluntary organizations privately. And they have a tradition of collecting material for over 100 years and more. So finding material should not be very difficult. Choosing the correct material and then doing the translation are going to be the challenging tasks.
We have discussed this briefly, sir, and I've gotten an opportunity to hear your words on the difficulty of translating Marathi in particular and why it's tricky. Could you maybe elaborate on that? Why, what the challenges are likely to be as one translates from Marathi to English in particular?
You must be warned that I am not an expert on translations. But at the same time, I feel strongly that the intellectual traditions of one language should be known to people not speaking that language, and therefore translations are important. The trouble with translations, as I understand it, is threefold. One is contextual or temporal. Someone writing in 1857 maybe or 1875, and then you are translating her or him today. So the reader might not know what were the references that the author is mentioning in her or his writings. That's one part of the challenge. The other part of the challenge is terminology. I use a Marathi word, and if you asked me to translate that into English, though I claim to be bilingual and understand English fairly well, I might not be able to do that. And therefore, I might have to be creative in first understanding what is the meaning of the Marathi word, and then how can it be transliterated into English. So that's the second challenge. And then the third, probably most important challenge, is that every language has its own style or structure. And therefore, even from Hindi into Marathi or Marathi into Hindi, the structure of the sentence actually changes from the end to the beginning. That is something that a translator has always to keep in mind, that doing literal translation is doing violence to both the original author and the reader. My job, if I were translating something, is to remain true to what is originally said, to try to be as creative in making it palatable to someone who doesn't understand that language, but at the same time, write something which reads well. When I read something which is translated, I shouldn't be simply conscious that this is after all a translation, and therefore I am finding so many difficulties in understanding what is being said. The translation has to be smooth. The sentences in English, for example, you write a sentence. When I translate it into Marathi, I would probably cut it into two or three parts and write two sentences instead of just translating sentence to sentence. That is what I would call verbatim. And that verbatim translation might not always help if we were to do justice to both the author and the reader.
So it's an intuitive form of translation as well that you're saying, that one has to be able to understand the text before one translates it and to be familiar with it.
Absolutely. I mean, I know that there are serious translation courses in many institutions, and they are most welcome, because unless you have that training, you can't really be doing translations. But at the same time, as you rightly pointed out, the translator must understand the spirit of what is being said, the gusto with which a particular argument, polemic, rhetoric is being made in the original, and bring that. You know, this has been confronted by many languages for many reasons. If someone were reading Marx in English, that flavor of the German, and there have been among Marxists also fights as to which translation is correct, whether the translation supported by the German scholars is correct or the Russian scholars is correct, and so on and so forth. I think these debates are necessary, but we are yet to enter into that stage. Our first step would be to facilitate translations and to create this culture of translating so that we know what is happening in other languages.
Absolutely. And in fact, I'm reminded, sir, of the famous debate around Marx, and he uses two words for representation, one which is political and one which is cultural, and the huge debate around that and how do we translate that accurately. Sure. English. So absolutely, you've sort of moved towards this end of your conversation where you say what we have to build is a culture of translation and facilitating that. I wonder if I might ask you what your hope is for India in the next 10, 20 years, what you'd hope for from translation in particular.
I think gradually this need that there should be translations is dawning upon all of us. Earlier, let's say pre-independence period, people used to be multilingual in the genuine sense of the term. Not just bilingual, but multilingual. They would know their language, they would know the language of the neighboring areas, regions. They would know maybe one more Indian language. And of course, they would study Sanskrit, they would study English, and so on. Today, in spite of the very half-hearted implementation of the three-language formula as it was struck in the 1960s, we barely know any other language. If you were to conduct this interview in Hindi with me, I would be faltering for many terms while speaking to you in Hindi, in spite of having studied Hindi and having been able to read Hindi. So I think this is a new step. The next step probably would be that we would be translating from one Indian language to another Indian language. At the moment, we are only looking forward to English as one of the possible languages where you translate the material from Indian languages. The next step definitely will have to be this kind of inter-language conversations among Indian languages themselves.
Absolutely. And in fact, I'm a native Hindi speaker, but I often find exactly what you describe, that in Hindi, it's very hard to find the right academic terms, for example, because all our studies and our academia is so English oriented and so Anglophone. So in fact, even for somebody whose second language is Hindi, it can be very difficult to find the right terms. So lots of fascinating points there. I wonder if I might ask you to make a comment on the New India Foundation Translation Program venture in particular.
I'm fascinated by the project. Otherwise, I wouldn't be giving this interview to you. You know, this is something which probably we are starting far too late. India should have started doing this maybe immediately after independence. Certainly around the 25th anniversary of our independence. And now here we are around in celebrating the 75th anniversary of our independence when we are doing it. But yes, this is important. The New India Foundation program and its fellowship idea is important, mainly because it is coming from the society itself. It's not presided over by the government in any sense of the term. And I'm not saying this because governments are good or bad. I am saying this because, after all, it is our treasure as a public treasure. And therefore, it has to be a public initiative. The New India Foundation represents that public initiative. And therefore, I think this is a most welcome step. I am aware, of course, of the various other initiatives of the New India Foundation. I am also aware that there is a national translation mission which is going on parallel to this. And a lot of work is being planned and done by that mission as well. And my only point would be more the merrier. I wish good luck, just as I wish good luck to the National Translation Mission. I would wish all the good luck to this fellowship program, but much more so for this fellowship program, because it sort of digs into our past, encourages us to be both multilingual and scholarly at the same time, and then supports the idea of translations in terms of resources. Because moral support is always welcome, but unless there is a very solid foundation of material support, resources, such initiatives cannot stand on their legs. Cultures are important. The culture of translation can also mushroom, flourish, and become common only with this kind of a resourceful foundation supporting it.